Everyone, myself Dr. Sarita. This video is a continuation of the previous video on My Last Duchess by Robert Browning. We had completed till line 30 and here I continue with line 31. She thanked men, good, but thanked somehow, I know not how, as if she ranked my gift of a 900 years old name with anybody's gift. The Duke here claims that although it's all well and good to thank people for doing things for you, the way the Duchess thanked people seemed to imply that she thought the little favors they did were just as important as what the Duke himself did for her. After all, the Duke gave her his 900 years old name, a connection to a long-standing aristocratic family with power and prestige. The Duke's family has been around for nearly 1,000 years running things in Ferrara, and he thinks this makes him superior to the Duchess, who doesn't have the same heritage. He thinks the Duchess ought to value the social elevation of her marriage over the simple pleasures of life. Next few lines. Who would stoop to blame this sort of trifling? The Duke asks his listener a rhetorical question. Rhetorical question is a question where the answer is implied. Who would actually lower himself and bother to have an argument with the Duchess about her indiscriminate behavior? He thinks the answer is nobody. We don't think there is much open and honest communication in this relationship. Continuing, even had you skill in speech, which I have not, to make your will quite clear to such an one and say, just this or that in you disgusts me, here you miss or dare you exceed the mark. And if she let herself be lessened so, nor plainly set her wits to yours for soothe and made excuse, even then would be some stooping, and I choose never to stoop. The Duke lists all the obstacles that prevented him from talking to the Duchess directly about his problem with her behavior. He claims that he doesn't have the skill in speech to explain what he wants from her, but his skillful rhetoric in the rest of the poem suggests otherwise. He also suggests that she might have resisted being lessened, that is, taught a lesson by him, if she had made excuse for her behavior instead. But even if he were a skilled speaker and even if she didn't argue, he says he still wouldn't talk to her about it. Why? Because he thinks that bringing it up all would be stooping to her level, and he refuses to do that. Next few lines. Oh, sir, she smiled, no doubt, whenever I passed her. But who passed without much the same smile? The Duke admits to his listener, who is this guy anyway, that the Duchess was sweet to him? She did smile at him whenever he passed by her. But he says, it's not like that. It's not like that was special. She smiles at everyone in the same way. Continuing the lines, 45 and 46. This grew. I gave commands, then all smiles stopped together. The Duke claims that this grew, that is, the Duchess's indiscriminate kindness and appreciation of everything got more extreme. This line has been declared as a one-line tragedy. The Duke then gave commands, and as a result, all smiles stopped together. Our best guess is that he had her killed, but the poem is ambiguous on this point. It's possible that he had her shut up in a dungeon or a nunnery and that she is as good as dead. She is not his Duchess anymore. She is his last Duchess, so she is clearly not on the scene anymore. Most probably dead. There she stands as if alive. Will it please you rise? The Duke ends his story of the Duchess and her painting by gesturing towards the full body portrait again, in which she stands as if alive. We'll meet the company below then. The Duke invites his listener to get up and go back downstairs to the rest of the company. As in line 5, this sounds like a polite invitation, but we can't imagine anyone refusing. Lines 48 to 53, I repeat, the count your master is known, munificence, is ample warrant that no just pretense of mine for dowry will be disallowed, though his fair daughter self, as I avowed at starting, is my object. We finally learn why the Duke is talking to this guy. His listener is the servant of a count, and the Duke is wooing the count's daughter. The Duke tells the servant that he knows about the count's wealth and generosity or munificence, so he expects to get any reasonable dowry he asks for. But his main object in the negotiations is the daughter herself, not more money. Nay, we'll go together down, sir. The Duke's listener seems to try to get away from him. We would try too. The Duke stops him and insists that they stay together as they go back to meet everyone else downstairs. Notice Neptune, though, taming a seahorse, thought a rarity, which Claus of Innsbruck cast in bronze for me. Before the Duke and his listener leave the gallery, the Duke points out one more of his art objects, a bronze statue of Neptune, the god of sea, taming a seahorse. The Duke mentions the name of the artist who cast this statue, Claus of Innsbruck, who made it specifically for him. Let's briefly summarize the poem before ending the video. The Duke of Ferrara is negotiating with a servant for the hand of a count's daughter in marriage. We don't know anything about the count except that he is a count and that he is not the count from the Sesame Street, different guy. During the negotiations, the Duke takes the servant upstairs into his private art gallery and shows him several of the objects in his collection. The first of these objects is a portrait of his last or former duchess, painted directly on one of the walls of the gallery by a friar named Pandolf. The Duke keeps this portrait behind a curtain that only he is allowed to draw, while the servant sits on a bench. The first of these objects is a portrait of his last or former duchess, painted directly on one of the walls, as I previously said, by Frau Pandolf. Apparently, the Duchess was easily pleased. She smiled at everything and seemed just as happy when someone brought her a branch of cherries, as she did when the Duke decided to marry her. So she also blushed easily. The Duchess's genial nature was enough to throw the Duke into a jealous rage, psychopathic rage, and he gave commands that meant all smiles stopped together. Line 46. We are guessing this means that he had killed her, although it's possible that he had shut her up somewhere, such as in a convent. But it's way more exciting if you interpret it as murder, as most critics do. After telling this story to the servant of the family that might provide his next victim, bride, the Duke takes him back downstairs to continue their business. On the way out, the Duke points out one more of his favorite art objects, a bronze statue of Neptune taming a seahorse. Thank you. I hope this has been useful for you.